Hello and hi to everyone. Myself Dr. B. Ashok from Department of Automotive Engineering, belongs to School of Mechanical Engineering from VET University, Vellore, India. And my corresponding contact details are given below. Please, if you have any queries related to this lecture or previous lecture in my course, you can be able to mail me. Okay, let's enter into the today's presentation, which is nothing but introduction to Electronic Control Unit, ECU. And this is the continuation of lecture series in regards to automotive electronics, and this can be useful towards both BTEC and MTEC automotive students having this course or related to the automotive courses. Any steps, this will be an useful course. Okay, and come to the today's topic. ECU. ECU is nothing but an electronic control unit, which is a generic name, and this component is used nowadays in almost in all the vehicles other than two-wheelers in India. Other than two-wheelers and three-wheelers in India, this electronic control unit is used in all the vehicles. So the electronic in an automotive is originated from the need of control of engines. So the very first electronic control is needed in the vehicle is that to control the engines to produce the optimum and the best performance and to produce the less emissions. The first electronic pieces were used to control the engine functions and were referred to as engine control unit. At very first, this electronic component, which is nothing but a microcontroller embedded with the respective programs which is used to control the engine, is being introduced in the vehicle. And later on, it has been used in the other systems, controlling the other systems like braking, transmission, suspension system, etc. So at very first it has been used in engine, so primarily it is called as a engine control units. But later on it has been introduced in to control the other system functions also, so it has been called as electronic control unit. So as an electronic control begins to be used for more automotive application, the acronym ECU took on more general meaning of electronic control unit, and then specific ECUs were developed. Specific ECUs in the sense, at very first only it is used for engine, and now the specific ECUs has been developed, like the ECU used for controlling the braking, it is called as anti-lock braking system ECU. If the ECU used for controlling the cluster, then it is called as instrument cluster ECU. If the ECU used for controlling the suspension, then it is called as suspension ECU. If the ECU used for controlling the gearbox, then it is called as a gearbox or transmission ECU. So the ECU is a generic name, and it according to the ECU where it is used in the systems, it will belongs to the particular system along with the ECU name. So you should not get confused between a ECU or you can say the engine control unit and electronic control unit. Okay, so it doesn't mean that ECU means only the engine control unit. ECU, it may be used for controlling the various systems like engine, transmission, braking, etc. Okay, so the in modern day vehicles you may be able to see up to 100 ECUs, and commercial vehicles up to 40 ECUs. That even 100 ECUs not in all the vehicles, it will be present only in the highly sophisticated vehicles. Highly sophisticated vehicles in the sense BMW 7 series, 5 series, or Mercedes S-Class, E-Class, like higher class vehicles, it might be using the more than 100 ECUs, or you can say up to 100 ECUs. But if you take in case of a normal Indian vehicles like Maruti Swift, Swift Dzire, i20, these category vehicle, it may be using the what you called around 25 to 30 ECUs, or slightly lesser than that. So the number of ECUs will be used in a vehicle to vehicle, it will be vary from according to the cost requirement and its usage. If more number of ECUs were used, then more number of control functions will be controlled by means of electronic way. If less number of ECUs were used, then less number of electronic control functions will be enabled. So automotive electronics are automotive embedded systems or distributed systems, and according to the different domains in the automotive field. So according to the ECUs used where, or according to the classifications of the automotive electronic domains, the automotive electronics can be classified as engine electronics, transmission electronics, chassis, active safety, driver assistance, like this. So the introduction about ECU, short for electronic control unit. The ECU is a name given to a device that controls one or more electrical systems in a vehicle. For example, electrical systems in the sense, the system may be, or you can say the systems may be a engine is a system, braking is a system, suspensions is a system, transmission is a system, power steering is a system, airbag is a system. Like that, if the ECU used for controlling any one system, then that ECU belongs to the particular ECU system. For example, if the ECU used for controlling the engine, then it is an engine control module, or EMS, engine management system, or EDC, like this, or PCM, different varieties of names they will be calling. If the ECU used for controlling the transmission, then it is called as TCM, transmission controlling module. Similarly, if the ECU used for controlling body related functions, BCM, anti-lock braking module, it is called as ABS. Like this, it will be able to classify it. So the ECU provides the instruction for various electrical systems. Various electrical systems, in the sense, it may get the input from the various sensors, and based on the inputs, it may be able to control the various electrical system outputs like actuators. If you take various actuators in the vehicle, or you can say in the engine, or injectors, throttle actuator, EGR actuator, like this. If you take in case of braking system, again solenoids, motors, like this. From a system to system, the number of sensors, or the type of the sensors, and the number of actuators, and the type of the actuators will be varied, and types of the program will be varied. But the ECU is a common device, or you can say ECU is a general device. It may be used for engine control, or it may be used for brake control, but it is a separate ECU, separate device. In automotive electronics, electronic control unit is a generic term for any embedded system that controls one or more of the electrical systems or subsystem in a transfer vehicles. So here you can able to see the types of ECUs based on its application. Okay, so the types of application it includes vary from here. I have only listed 9 ECUs. Other than this, there are a lot of other ECUs like braking, door control, immobilizer, keyless entry, like this, lot of ECUs you can able to classify. So if any system it needs a more sophisticated control, then you can go for using the ECUs in the particular module. So sophisticated controls, so 70 to 100 ECUs inside a modern car, even more than that. So why this kind of ECUs are supposed to be used, or why this many number of so has been used? So before emission laws were introduced, it was possible to build a car engine without microprocessor or microcontroller. So without emission controlling mechanism, or without the need of emission control mechanism, you can build a mechanically operated car. But nowadays it is not only possible to develop a mechanically operated car, it's supposed to be mechanically operated, but it has to be controlled by means of electronical way. So that controlling of electronical way is nothing but a ECU. So here they have given us 70 to 100, so 70 to 100 systems will be controlled by 70 to 100 separate ECUs. So there is no common single device which is used to control all the functions. For separate systems, there will be separate ECU. So why this ECU has been used only after emission laws were introduced? Because the mechanical systems are not alone sufficient to provide a better output control. For example, mechanical system, in the sense, the mechanical system based carburetor in SI engine, or the mechanical injection in a diesel engine, is not possible to provide a lesser emission and more output to meet the emission norms. So as the emission norms has been introduced, the more stringent way of emission values has to be followed. It means that, for example, in India, the BS4 emission norms as of now we are following, but in other European countries already they are following Euro 6 norms. But in India, from BA 2020 onwards, we are planning to move towards the BS6 emission norms. So as the emission norms just keeps on increasing, the amount of pollutant level has to be decreased drastically. So the mechanical way of controlling air and the fuel in an SI engine, or in case of a CI engine, is not sufficient to meet these norms. So you should provide a better sophisticated electronic control. So that sophisticated electronic control, in the sense, ECU has to control the proper amount of air and fuel. Apart from the air and fuel, other functions also has to be controlled. Primarily, the role of the ECU is only supposed to control the air and fuel in case of engine control. But nowadays, apart from the air and fuel control, other systems such as throttle control, turbocharger control, EGR control, lot of parameters has been able to control by means of modern day electronic control unit in an engine. So for this the meeting the emission norms, the ECU has been introduced. So once the ECU has been introduced in the engine, because of its ability to control the system in a real time basis, in the sense, right now what is the operating point of the engine, operating point of the driver, all the conditions will be monitored and able to control the output. So because of this real time operating feature, the ECU has been started to use in other systems as well, other system control as well, like used in the braking system, used in the suspension system, used in the transmission system, and keeps on this increasing nowadays. And there is a chance that even more number of ECUs are going to be used in the future. Right now in Indian category vehicle only 20-25 ECUs are used, means even this can be increased to higher level. And even in a higher branded vehicles or a higher sophisticated vehicles, the number of ECU has to be going to increase in nearby future. So this ECU uses a closed loop control that monitors the output of any system. It may be an engine, if it may be a braking system, it will monitor the output, and that output will be fed back into the input, and based on the feedback, based on the input, the error will be able to be reduced with the help of proper sophisticated controls. A modern ECU might contain 32-bit or 64-bit or even lesser than that, depending upon the number of input and output, and depending upon the control features, its speed of the processor will be varied. Reason for more number of ECUs. As I have already discussed, sophisticated engine controls needs to be met to meet the emission norms and meet the fuel economy standards. The modern day engine or the modern day vehicle has to use the engine ECU, and of course more number of modern day control system needs, ECU has to be used in the other system as well. And next one is advanced diagnostic, in the sense, as the number of electronic components are keeps on increasing, it is difficult to diagnose the system. If any problem will be persisting or if any problem will be have in the system, it is difficult to trace out those problems. In that case, you should go for a diagnostic system. So the diagnostic system will be part of every ECU. Each ECU should have a separate diagnostic module. So that diagnostic module can able to monitor the system function, input and as well as output, even the ECU level functions, but even the system level function. If any fault is there, immediately it will store that fault with the help of any trouble codes. Separate codes will be assigned, and immediately it may able to display that fault in the cluster, instrument cluster, that is a driver dashboard. In front of the driver, you may be see a lot of small lights will be glowing, so it may able to display over there. So for that, because of the more number of ECUs, to provide advanced diagnostic features, ECU has been introduced. Simplification of the manufacturing and design, of course. For example, if you see, as once the ECU has been used in the braking system, along with the EBD, electronic brake force distribution, one of the component called as LSPV, a load sensing proportionating valve, has been replaced. This is a simple example I am quoting. Like this, if you are able to use the ECU, more number of mechanical components can be replaced. So that's what it will be able to provide, the simplification in manufacturing design. Of course, mechanical point of view, it provides a more simplification, but electronic point of view, more complication will be coming. So that we will discuss in a later part. And reduction of amount of wiring harness. As more number of electronic components used, more number of wires will be used, to be frank. But nowadays, these users are using along with the communication protocols. Separate communication protocols will be used, like CAN, LIN or FlexRay, like those things. So in that case, more number of communication protocols will be used, so we can able to reduce the amount of wiring harness. And new safety features, as because of the more number of ECUs like airbag, seat belt, collision avoidance system, lane departure warning, by means of these features you can able to go for a more number of safety features. And of course, you can put new comfort and convenience features like automatic climate control, temperature control, in-cabin light control, seat heating, seat massaging, seat cooling. Like this, you can able to go for a more number of comfort and convenience features like cruise control, adaptive cruise control. Like this, you can able to go for it. And of course, increase the overall performance of the vehicle in a system level and as well as the overall vehicle level, like engine performance level or a braking performance level or a particular suspension performance level, it can able to improve. So because of all these collective reasons, we have been gone for a more number of ECUs in the vehicle. So this is a typical picture of an ECU, which is an engine ECU. You can able to see these black color ports are the which consist of pins, which can able to communicate towards all the input and output devices. And of course, a CAN port, flex ray port, debug port, power port, all the port will be connected. And inside the box, you may able to see a PCB board with the help of a lot of electronic components embedded on it to provide a effective control features and the functions. And what are the components of the ECU? Or you can say ECU consists of what? Electronic control unit consists of both hardware and software. So the hardware part of the ECU is comparatively less cost as compared to the software in any ECU. If you take the majority of the cost in developing the ECU goes to the software part rather than the hardware. And of course, depending upon the number of units, as the number of components, number of production pieces increases, the cost may come down. That is apart from our discussion. Okay, so in the hardware part, you can able to see the printed circuit board PCB of the ECU consists of the microcontroller chip or the central processing unit. So this is the primary and most important component in the ECU system. So the software is stored in this microcontroller or other chips on the PCB. An ECU can be reprogrammed by updating the software or by replacing the chips. Okay, so an ECU can be able to possible to update the software and replace the chips. So at this point, I am going to stress one more important discussion, is that a classification of ECUs. In 2-3 slides, we have discussed about the types of ECUs based on application. Okay, or where it is applied. Like if the ECU is used for engine, it is called as engine ECU. ECU used for braking, then it is called as a braking ECU. Like that, vice versa. We have discuss in the same manner ECU classifications based on its accessibility, how you can able to access or how you can able to access the program or access the component or access the entire ECU. We can able to classify as three different types. One is closed ECU, another one is a fully open ECU, and another one is a semi or partially open ECU. Please note down is this three. I am again repeating. Closed ECU, which is able to see in all the road running vehicles, you can't able to access anything. And another one is a partially open ECU, and another one is a fully open ECU. These two ECUs were be able to used in the developmental stage. Okay, in case of fully open ECU, you can able to access all the programs and all the codes, all the lookup tables, all the datas. But whereas in case of a partially or a semi open ECU, only part of the program can be able to access. Like you can't able to access any programs, but rather than the programs, you can able to access only the lookup tables and the lookup tables and the data maps. Just you can able to access that. That's what you can able to change, the lookup table of ignition timing, injection timing, like lot of values can be changed. That's it. But you can't able to access the real program. Okay, so that's what I want to stress over here. So the ECU consists of lot of input and output devices. Okay, so the input devices are nothing but all the sensors and the data inputs by the way of electrical signal to the ECU, which in turn controls the various actuators. So all the sensors and switches are act as the input towards the ECU, and the actuators, various actuators, or you can say control the functions in a particular system, or act as the output. So sensors are nothing but it will senses the physical signal and it will converts into the electrical output, and of course actuators are nothing but converting the controlled electrical signal to the mechanical output. So these are all the key elements of the ECU. So one of the main key element is the core microcontroller. That is the primary component in the ECU. Other than that, it consists of various memory devices like static RAM, electronically erasable program, flash memory, all those things. And of course, various inputs and outputs. That's what we'll call as I/O devices. Input devices may be supply voltage, higher voltage, low voltage, or like that. And other inputs like digital inputs, analog inputs. So the sensors may be in the form of digital way or analog way or in a different manner. And similarly, the outputs will be in the form of relay drivers, H-bridge, edge bridge drivers, injector drivers, logic outputs like this. There are, depending upon the type of the system to the type of the system, the number of outputs and the type of the outputs will be varied. And of course, the very last one is the communication chips or the communication links, where it is used to communicate between one ECU to another ECU. So there are as many ECUs present in a vehicle. So depending upon the nature, depending upon the requirement, the way of communications can be varied. So this is a typical pictorial representation of a simple single cylinder engine, a single cylinder engine which is operated by this ECU, belongs to the Freescale microcontroller. Here you can able to see the core microcontroller is present in the middle of the system, and of course there are different ports which is used to connect the input and outputs. All input sensors and output actuators will be connected towards this port, and of course there will be a separate controller for controlling or providing the CAN communication, and CAN port will be there, so this will be used to connect towards the other ECU for the CAN communication. Later again we can say what is in the CAN in detail. And of course the flex ray port is also now the communication port, and reset button, and of course power button, which is a major important component in the EC system. So this is a typical PCB board fixed with the other required electronic components for an electronic control unit. You can able to classify the electronic control unit components into three different areas are four different areas. Like the primary one is the processor, and of course the remaining two are the input and output devices. So all the input sensors, like if you'll take in case of an engine, starting from engine speed sensor, engine piston position, air quantity, temperature, oil level, lambda sensor, all the sensors will be act as the input. And of course in case of engine, the output will be like injector, spark plug, or you can say ignition coil, turbo actuator, throttle actuator, like this. If you go for a braking system, again brake pedal input, wheel speed sensor, output will be the solenoid. So like this, from a system to system, the number of inputs and number of outputs will be varied. Okay, if the in case of engine system, it one type of inputs and one type of outputs will be there, or some n type of inputs, number of inputs may be 20 like that. If you go for a braking system, again it may be varying between 5 to 10. So depending upon a system to system, the number of inputs and number of outputs will be varied. So the processor is packaged in a module with hundreds of other components on multi-layer circuit board. So this is a typical processor. It will be packed with the other components in the multi-layer circuit board. And other than the core processor, it consists of analog to digital converter, digital to analog converter, signal conditioner units, communication chips. These are all the different components present in the ECU. So if you see the process flow of the ECU, how the signal will be flowing, or you can say how the controlling process will be happening, means at very first the sensor and switches will senses the data, and it does, those data will be in the form of analog, but that the analog data cannot be able to be read by the processor. So in that case ADC will convert it into the analog to digital converter. So once the information will be given to the processor will process the input sensor signals by the program you have written. The program may be in the form of control functions like PID controller, fuzzy controller, or adaptive controller, along with the form of lookup tables or the maps present in the system. And based on that, it will take a decision of a controlled output. At this point, there will be a controlled output will be there. This controlled output will be given to the digital to analog converter. So the output of the processor will be in the form of digital, which is nothing but a 5 volt controlled signal. But this 5 volt controlled signal is not able to drive the actuators. So in that case, there is a process of driver circuits like IGBT based, MOSFET based, different power electronic based driver circuits will be there. So that driver circuits will be able to control the actuators. So the actuators will be present in the respective systems. Okay, this actuator and the sensors both will be present in the respective system. For example, in case of engine means n number of sensors and n number of actuators will be present. In case of braking system means again it will be present in the braking systems. Okay. So what is the function of each and every component in the ECU systems? role of analog to digital converter. As I have already told you, all the inputs are the sensors will sensing in the form of either in the way of analog or in the way of digital. If it is sensed in the way of digital, then there is no need for analog to digital converter. If it is in the sensed in the way of analog, then it is need of a analog to digital converters. And again, sorry, high level digital outputs. On many modern cars, the ECU actuates the actuator, such as solenoids, motors relays, etc. All of these tasks requires digital output. So a digital output either the on off in between, like a PWM or something like that. Similarly, digital to analog converters, because as I told you, the processor will provide the digital output. So the digital output will not be possible to read by the what you called the respective actuators, or you can say the driver circuit. So in that case, you should have the digital to analog converters. So this will be also part of the what you called ECU components. Next one is a signal conditioners. The signal conditioners are the one of the important components in the ECU systems, because sometimes the inputs or outputs needs to be adjusted before they read. Say the sensor input may be weak, it will be more noisy, more disturbance will be there, so it has to be amplified or it has to be filtered. So a lot of signal conditioning process has to be happened in there, so before this input has to be processed. So for that, you should have a separate signal conditioning circuit in the ECU. So this signal conditioning circuit will be part of the PCB board, and it will process all the, or you can say it will condition all the sensor informations, and then only it will be given to the respective core processor. So sorry. So again, this will be an important component. The next one is a communication chip. As I told you, this communication chip is one of the important component in the modern day ECU system. For example, I have told you there are a lot of ECUs were present in the vehicle, isn't it? For an engine, there is a separate ECU. For a braking, there will be a separate ECU. For a cluster, there will be a separate ECU. For a suspension, there will be a separate ECU. Say, I will just ask you one question. If brake pedal is pressed, okay, there is a presence of brake switch below the brake pedal. So that switch will provide the output when the brake pedal is pressed, whether it is pressed partially or whether it is pressed fully, like that it may able to sense. So that brake pedal information is needed by what are all the ECUs. Okay, again I am repeating the question. If the brake pedal is pressed by the driver, that information will be needed by what are all the ECUs. Like engine ECU, it needs that information. Why? Because depending upon the brake pedal pressing, the engine output has to be controlled, isn't it? The fuel injection quantity has to be reduced or the air quantity has to be reduced. Similarly, when the brake pedal is pressed, the gear change or the gearbox, if it is a gearbox, is an automatic control, automatic transmission is there, then that ECU needs that information. And of course, there is a presence of anti-lock braking system, means the braking system has to be controlled by the ABS ECU. So that ECU needs that braking brake pedal information. And similarly, the body related functions are controlled by the body control module ECU, isn't it? So that ECU needs, when the brake pedal is pressed, to control the rear brake switch or rear stop light switch has to be on. So just an example, a single brake pedal input is pressed, or you can say sorry, single brake pedal switch input has been needed by four different ECUs, like engine ECU, transmission ECU, brake pedal ECU, body control module ECU. But there is a presence of only one switch. So for that, in a normal mode, what you will do without communication, you can able to provide a four different wires or four different connection to the four different ECUs, isn't it? So the number, in this way, what will happen? Number of wires will be increased, weight of the wire, cost of the wire, complications will be increased. And like this is for a single information. In this manner, there are n number of inputs, sorry, which will be needed by other ECUs. Like a camshaft, engine speed is needed by different ECU. Like lot, particular ECU, particular information is not only used by particular ECU. That information is needed for another ECU to provide an effective control function output. So in that case, the more number of ECUs needs many number of inputs. So it is not advisable, or it is not good to provide separate wire to the separate inputs. So for that, they have been gone for a controller area network. Controller area network is nothing but a CAN, which is a protocol or a communication protocol like a LIN or a LAN communication between one PC to another PC. In the same manner, this controller area network is a communication between one ECU to another ECU. Here it is nothing but it is a two-wire network, or you can say a two-wire protocol. Whatever the information gathered by a particular ECU, which will be float into the or it will be passed in the CAN network. So whichever the ECU needs any information from the passage, it will take that information. If it is not needed by the any unknown ECU, it won't take it. For example, the brake pedal information is needed by the braking ECU, means it will take that information. Suspension ECU may not need that information, so it won't take that. So whichever the ECUs are present in that CAN line, those ECUs will take that information. So by means of this, we can able to reduce the complexity of the wiring harness and reduce the cost of the system, and you can improve the effectiveness in the controlled output, isn't it, our control system. These chips, nothing but the communication chips, implement the various communication standards that are used on the cars. So it is based on the separate communication standards. There are several standards used, but the one that stating to dominate in car communication is called as a controller area networking. That is nothing but a CAN bus communicates with, by means of using two wires. Nowadays, at very first, it has been used, it has been implemented only in the automotive is used, but nowadays it has been, this CAN communication has been used between the or used in the other segments as well. Another benefit of having a communication bus is that each module can communicate faults to the central module, which stores the faults and can communicate them to an off-board diagnostic tool. For example, here we can able to classify as onboard diagnostic and offboard diagnostic. Later on, I will say what is the onboard and offboard diagnostic. So, a diagnostic is nothing but if any problem in the particular ECU, that ECU will diagnose on its own. That information has to be put into the cluster. That is another ECU, isn't it? So, for that, those informations will be communicated through in the CAN protocol. This can make it easier for technicians to diagnose the problem with the car, especially intermittent problems, which are notorious for disappearing as soon as you bring the car in for repairs. For example, some problems will be sometimes it will be coming and sometimes it may not be coming. The faults will be stored, but if you will able to communicate or if you will able to connect any kind of another diagnostic module, you can able to note down that fault. ECU functioning. So by means of having all these components, how the ECU will be operated or how the ECU will be functioning. For example, first, sensor conditioning. That is nothing but analog and digital. The sensors may be, the sensor output may be in the form of analog way or may be in the form of digital way. So whatever it might be, it will first undergoes the signal conditioning process, all the sensor inputs. It will able to, the signal may be filtered, amplified, attenuated for electronic ESD, electrostatic discharge, or electromagnetic interference protections, all those things will be happen. And then it will be given to the core processor. Then the processor, it will execute the software based on the inputs taken from the particular sensors. So here, based on it, will the program may uses the formulas, algorithms, lookup tables, functions, a lot of things may be able to do it and compare it, and it will either provide the output in the form of any error or any safety checks or any cell test or some kind of controlled output. That controlled output, either it will be given and given to the actuators for controlling the actuators, or if any error is there or any safety problem is there, then it will indicate to the driver. If any information has to be provided, then it will provide the vehicle informations or intercommunication between the ECU. Intercommunication in the sense, for example, say a simple example I can quote you. For example, if the vehicle has got into the accident, the very first ECU should know the accident has been happened is that the airbag ECU, isn't it? Because once the accident is happened, within the next 30 or 40 milliseconds, the airbag will be inflated. So the very first ECU knows the accident has been happened is the airbag ECU with the help of lot of sensors. That airbag immediately inflated or the accident has been happened, immediately that collision information will be floated in the CAN protocol, and it will be given to the all other ECUs. Like for example, if the accident has been happened, immediately the engine has to be shut off, and all the doors has to be opened, the battery has to be disconnected. So all these functions has to be done. So immediately, based on the software execution, immediately it may be able to communicate to the other ECUs or for the other ECUs to note down or to mention the accident has been happened. So immediately you carry on the respective functions. Once the accident has been happened, what are all the functions you will do? You have you take it, you take the decision, like that it will give the information. So this is a simple example I have quoted. So this is the typical functioning of the ECU system. So next comes to the components associated with the ECU, like sensors. Sensor is the one of the important and input component in the ECU system. It is nothing but it will convert all the physical signals into electrical output. Physical signals in the sense like a temperature, pressure, angle, position, concentration. The sensors may be able to sense all these physical parameters with the presence of lot of noises or cross sensitivities, whatever it may be, and it will provide the output in the form of either analog way or a digital way or a discrete manner. That is nothing but a this digital manner. Next one is the actuators. Actuators are the output devices. So please note down that sensors are act as the input to the ECU and actuators are act as the output from the ECU. Both the sensors and actuators will be present in the respective system. So the sensors will use to measure the real-time operating characteristics of the system, and the actuators are used to control the operating feature of the respective system. Say if a braking system means the braking related functions will be measured with the help of the braking related sensors, and the braking related control will be happened by means of the actuators. It will be similar in the case of engine. So the actuators are nothing but converting the electrical control, the controlled electrical output from the core microcontroller to the mechanical output. It will either move, it is a solenoid or a motor. Based on the electrical input, either it will move the solenoid, that arm or motor, either it may be a DC motor, stepper motor, thermal actuators, piezo actuators, relay switch. Like this, different varieties of actuators will be used. The term actuator will be used to mean a device that converts electrical signal into the mechanical movement. Based on the mechanical movement, the system process, or you can say the system output will be controlled, or you can say the system operation will be controlled. Say example, if you will take in case of the engine, means depending upon the sensor inputs, the ECU, the engine ECU will assess the input, and based on the program it will provide the output, and the output will be controlling the injector. Injector is nothing but a fluid, amount of fuel will be injecting, like air throttle actuator, it will control the amount of air. EGR actuator, turbo actuator, like this separate respective actuators will controlling the respective mechanical function of the system. I hope by this at this point of time you may able to understand clearly about the ECU system, what are the inputs and what are the outputs, what are the components present in the system. To be more to get a more understanding, I am just going to explain the working of one ECU for controlling the engine function. So here it is called as the engine ECU. Why I have took the engine ECU means because engine ECU is most prominently used and most widely used, and you people also more easily able to understand the working function. Okay, so the same manner the other systems will be used, other system ECU will be varied. For example, in the same manner, braking system, cluster system, airbag systems will be varied its function. Okay, so here the ECU is responsible for monitoring all the aspects of engine operation, making adjustments based on driver input and mode. The same definition will be applicable towards other system also. In case of braking system, the ECU is responsible for monitoring all the aspects of braking operation, making adjustment based on the driver and based on the vehicle output or the vehicle functions. Okay, so only the ECU's function is common. It will just control the any system's output or any system's operation based on the input provided to the ECU. So the system may be anything. System may be an engine, or system may be a braking, or system may be a suspension system. Why I am more and more stressing this point means because most of the students will get confused into the ECU. ECU means most of the persons will be mentioning as engine ECU, like engine control unit. But ECU is not alone used for controlling the engine. That's what I want to stress at this point, or at the end of the slide you may be easily able to understood clearly as well. Okay, so the ECU reads the amount of airflow entering into the engine to adjust the throttle, and it also controls the another functions. Like, it is not only measures the airflow, of course, crankshaft position, camshaft position, engine temperature, engine pressure, all these functions will be measured with the help of the respective sensors, and all these informations will be given to the ECU, or you can say the processor, and the processor will process all these informations based on the program written, and based on that it will provide the controlled output. So the controlled output may be controlling the air quantity, fuel quantity, any turbocharger or any other parameter. So that will be given to the respective actuators. So the ECU manages the ignition timing, idle speed, valve timing, throttle control, turbocharger control, etc., etc., in case of engine. So information is sent to the ECU from the sensors located throughout the engine bay. Engine bay is nothing but in front of the what you call bonnet. Once you will open the bonnet, the portion you may be able to see is the engine bay. So the information will be sent to the ECU with the help of the sensors located throughout the engine bay that do everything from measuring the coolant temperature to camshaft position, all the parameters. So typically in an engine, minimum 15 to 20 or 25 sensors will be present in the engine. So it again, the number of sensors will be present depending upon the type of the vehicle, or the type of the engine to type of the engine, cost of the vehicle to cost of the engine, and depending upon the functionalities, the number of sensors will be varied. So in short, the ECU has a huge impact on your vehicle operation, including everything from available power to emission control with respect to the engine operation. So depending upon the effective performance output of the ECU, the engine output, or you can say the, in terms of emission or performance, it will be able to varied. So the ECU is one of the important component which will be providing the effective output of an engine. By means of this picture, you can able to clearly understand. See here, this is a typical engine ECU, the typical representative engine ECU. So inside it, there will be a separate software. Okay. So it consists of number of I/O devices. Here they have mentioned only few devices. So other than this, there are a lot of other I/O input and output devices will be there. Like, there is a separate devices or separate sensors which is used to monitor the driver demand, like accelerator pedal sensor, idle speed position, brake pedal position, clutch, vehicle speed. Like this set of sensors will be monitoring the driver demand, and some other set of sensors will be monitoring the engine condition, like cooling temperature, coolant temperature, air quantity, boost pressure, engine speed, piston position. Like this both the set of inputs will be given to the software part of the microcontroller, and based on these two inputs, the software will be executing based on the program written, and it will make an controlled output from the ECU. The controlled output will be given to the respective actuators, like injection. Here they have mentioned only injection. Please note on it, other than the injector, there are a lot of other actuators also there, like throttle actuator, turbo actuator, EGR actuator, radiator fan, coolant pump. Like this, lot of actuators will be there. So depending upon the driver input and depending upon the engine condition, a comparative assessment will be happened, and based on the comparative assessment, depending upon the program, the controlled output will be given to the respective actuators to control the or to operate the engine system in an effective manner to produce a better output with less fuel economy and with less emission and with better fuel economy. Okay, so this is the ultimate working principle of an engine ECU. So in the same manner, other ECU systems or the other ECU also will be working. For example, if the braking system ECU means, in the braking system ECU, there will be a presence of set of sensors, and it will be given the real-time operating condition of the braking system, and based on the inputs from the sensors and based on the program written, the ECU may able to provide a controlled output towards the respective actuators present in the braking system. Okay, so at this point of time, I hope you might be able to clear the in the working the construction and working of the a typical ECU. Okay, and next comes to the design and development of the ECU. Okay, how the ECU is developed or how the ECU is designed and developed. To your knowledge, I am not sure how far you know who is developing the ECU, but basically the ECU, if the engine ECU or the cluster ECU or the braking ECU or any ECU is not developed or not produced by a OEM. OEMs are nothing but original equipment manufacturers such as Maruti Suzuki, Volkswagen, Ford, Hyundai. These are all the OEMs. They are only selling the vehicles. So, but they are not producing, as far as we know, they are producing the vehicle, but they will not produce all the components. They will procure from other suppliers. So one of such component is the ECU. So the ECU will be produced by the tier one suppliers. The tier one suppliers are like Bosch, Delphi, Continental, Magneti Marelli. So these are the certain suppliers who will be producing the are manufacturing the electronic control unit for engine, for controlling the braking, for suspension, for cluster. Like that, there is a separate suppliers, or even Bosch, Continental, they are producing the most of the ECUs. Okay, so the development of an ECU involves both hardware and software required to perform the functions expected from that particular module. Automotive ECUs are being developed by following the standard V model. Later on, we will see what is meant by V model technique. It is rare that a module is developed fully from scratch. Okay, so a typical ECU will not develop fully from scratch. The design is generally iterative and improvements are made to both hardware and software. For example, now next year they are going to launch one new vehicle in the middle segment in the cost of 7 to 8 lakhs by Maruti. What they will do, they will first take already whichever the vehicle in the 7 to 8 lakh same ECU, and they will, by means of general iterative process and other improvements, they will try to change the ECU. Okay, so they will not develop from the scratch. Okay, that's what here I want to stress. So the development of most ECUs are carried out by the tier 1 suppliers such as Bosch, Delphi, Continental, based on the specifications provided by the OEMs from Maruti Suzuki, Volkswagen, Ford, like that. Okay, design and testing again. Traditional way to develop the automotive embedded systems has to be built hardware boards that represents all or part of each ECU and part of its surrounding, often called as plant models, and use them for bench testing. First, creating all the needs hardware board is costly. Okay, so developing initially itself, developing entire hardware is most costly. Okay, so what they will do, they will first go for a software model. Okay, both ECU and as well as plant, both will be in a software model. So based on the software model, they will measure the performance, they will vary the output, they will vary the by means of iterative problems, they will do lot of modifications, and they will finalize the software part. Okay, and then they will go for the hardware testing. So finally, and most importantly, this bench testing approach is based on the sequential design process, where hardware is developed, plant model prototypes are built, and software development begins, isn't it? So either one will be hardware, will be developed, and another will be software, or both will be software, like this, vice versa, in the manner development will be varied. So to easily explain, I can tell you the help of this V model technique. To overcome the cost of development, time, all those things, control design engineers have adopted a highly efficient design process, often referred to as a V diagram. The one given below is typically what used in the ECU design cycle. First, system definition. System definition is nothing but the requirement of the system from a particular OEM. Okay. For example, I want to develop from this type of engine. This is the engine power output. This is the value like that. That is the system definition. So based on that system definition, they will go for a rapid prototyping. That is in the rapid prototyping. Before rapid prototyping, they will go for a soft terminal loop testing. That is a both system that is plant and ECU, both are in a mathematical model. They will go for a multiple iteration and they will check it and they will finalize the program. Okay. And they will target that, or you can say dump that program in the hardware, or the nothing but the ECU. And then the ECU is a hardware and the software part is the plant, mathematical model of the plant. Both will be coupled and it will be undergone a hardware loop testing. And then it is finalized, then they will go for both in a hardware, both system and as well as ECU, both in a hardware, and then they will go for a system level testing, and then they will connect in the vehicle and they will go for a whole vehicle level testing. So in the initial step, the design engineers documents the needs and requirements of the project using the spreadsheet or word processing application. What is the specification? What are the functions needed? All those things. The documentation also takes care about the various specification of the engine and the various norms needs to be complied with. Okay. It also marks the limit levels of the parameters involved in controlling the engine. What is the maximum minimum limit? What is the maximum limit? All those functions will be involved in this process. Once the specifications are documented, the actual design process begins, in which first a software model of the ECU and the engine is built. Here they have explained about engine. If it is for another system, again other system. Okay, so to be clearly, again I am saying, at very first software model, that is mathematical model of engine and mathematical model of plant. Okay, it may be engine or maybe braking, both will be built, and this will be built in the any kind of simulation software like MATLAB Simulink or Asset or the particular software developed by the particular manufacturer. Like Continental, they are using the inbuilt inbuilt some software. And once the model are built, the third step involves software and loop simulation. Software and loop simulation, both plant and as well as ECU, both are in a model. So that both will go undergone a software and loop testing. So in this step, both software models, ECU model and engine model, or you can say the plant, are connected together in a closed loop feedback loop and then simulated to analyze the dynamic characteristics of the entire system. How the system operating conditions will be there, for the input, the output will be varied or not, whether the engine process is happening correctly or not, because of the input is varied by the, or input is controlled by the ECU. All the functions will be monitored in the software form, in the software simulation form. During the simulation, the ECU model monitors the output from the engine model and adjusts the inputs to the engine model in order to improve the performance of the various engine functions like fuel economy, fuel injection timing, ignition timing, etc., etc. So now the software loop testing is over. So once the software loop testing is over, then they will go for a rapid prototype. Okay. In the rapid prototyping, again, either one thing will be in a hardware, that is a real engine they will go, but they will not go for a real ECU hardware. Again, ECU will be gone in the form of ECU model. Here in the picture you can able to see the real engine. This is a hardware engine, but instead of hardware ECU, they are still using the soft model of the ECU. Okay, so whatever the code was finalized in the software and loop testing, that will be targeted into the specific prototype hardware. It is also called as engine in loop simulation. We should not confuse this with the term rapid prototyping, which refers to a class of technologies that can automatically construct physical models from a computer aided design. Okay, so for rapid control prototyping, the software ECU model that has been designed is downloaded to real-time hardware prototype target. Okay, so whatever the ECU model which is used in the software and loop simulation, that will be downloaded to a real-time prototype target. As the software model of the ECU is given IO interfaces, which in turn connected to the sensors and the actuators attached to the engine. Okay, so this will be targeted into the ECU, will be target ECU software will be targeted into the real-time hardware, and all the sensors and actuators will be connected towards this system. So once this all this target will be targeted will be happening, the whatever the software model of the ECU will be converted into respective C codes through the C code generator, and this code is downloaded as the controller algorithm to the respective 32-bit microcontroller or a 64-bit microcontroller inside the ECU, and based on this the system will be tested. And next one is the hardware loop simulation. Previous thing is also called as a hardware loop simulation, and here this thing again they will develop the real ECU and they will go for a plant model, either engine model or directly also they can go for the engine, vice versa. But first they will develop the real ECU with the program finalized, and that program will be fed into the real ECU hardware that will control the plant model. Once the code containing the control algorithm is downloaded to the ECU test, the performance of the ECU under extreme conditions which cannot be achieved in the real world by performing it. Because here the hardware is ECU is used, but why the software model of engine is used means some of the extreme conditions cannot be generated or some of the extreme conditions cannot be developed. So for that they will go for a mathematical model in order to give the extreme conditions. So in this step the actual ECU is tested by simulating the engine using the engine model that we had created earlier. This IO, these inputs and outputs are then connected towards the actual ECU. Then various engine conditions can be simulated and the ECU can be tested to its limits, which would not possible if it was tested using an actual engine. So this is a typical hardware loop simulation. And again in the next process the plant engine model is replaced with a real engine. So this process will be repeated, and system level testing, engine ECU and engine alone will be tested. So that is a system level testing, and once that is finalized then that is freezed, then engine will be fixed in the vehicle and whole vehicle level testing will be happening, and then it is gone for a final production of the ECU and as well as the engine or the vehicle. And here in the ECU development, one of the important parameter is the tuning. Tuning is nothing but some people wants to change the data sets, or they want to change the data sets or programs or some of the lookup tables in the ECU. So that's what earlier I have told you, there are different types of ECUs. Either you can able to change the entire data set and as well as the lookup table, then it is called as a fully open ECU. If only you can able to change the lookup table, then it is called as a semi or partially open ECU. So this is called as a calibration. Okay. So the, for this there will be a separate calibration engineers are being used in the industries. So this is a typical schematic representation of the engine ECU tuning or calibration. Here you can see the entire engine will be put into the test bed. Okay, connected towards the dynamometer, and this will be controlled by the separate control function. And this is the fully open ECU connected towards the engine with the help of all the sensors and actuators. And this ECU will be accessed through the laptop. Okay, with the help of one interface called as INCA hardware and INCA software. Okay, because directly you can't able to access the any electronic component. So through the some interface you can able to what you call access this. So this INCA is nothing but a integrated calibration and acquisition system. So it will able to acquire the data. See, ECU acquire, ECU has, it will store all the data, all the sensors and actuator data. The data again it will be acquired through this laptop, through the INCA, and acquired data can be calibrated also. Calibrated in the sense you can able to change. For example, if you want to set some injection timing, you set 23 degree, that is not sufficient to provide the better engine output and emission, you can able to change it through the laptop. And again it will be in the online manner itself, through the engine operating time itself you can able to change all those things. In a similar manner the calibration for another systems will be varied. For braking system, engine is replaced by the braking and the engine ECU is replaced by the braking ECU. So system to system it will be varied. And next come, this is the INCA is nothing but a integrated calibration acquisition software. It consists of a measured data analysis system, calibration data manager, all those things. And next, the final part of the ECU is the diagnostic system module. So there are different diagnostic tools are needed, like multimeter, oscilloscope, and engine analysis has been used to diagnose the problem generally. But if any problem in the ECU, the ECU should know the self-diagnostic. First of all, that's what we'll call as the on-board diagnosis. On-board diagnosis, it will diagnose on its own and it will display the problem, but it won't rectify the problem. It will diagnose the problem. For example, a sensor may gone, or an actuator may be gone, a sensor's positive signal gone, like that a wire is disconnected, like that it will diagnose the problem. And it will indicate that problem through the cluster. It will inform the driver through the cluster. And for each and every problem, it will provide codes. Okay. For example, signal problem or signal ranges or values are allocated to all operating states of the sensors and actuators. If the signal deviates from normal, the ECU stores the standard fault code for both the series and minor faults. In case of series faults, a warning lamp will be also illuminated to alert the driver. So for each and every fault, there will be one code that is called as fault codes, P codes, C codes, B codes. P codes are related to powertrain related errors, C codes are related to chassis related, and B codes are related to body related errors. Each and every electronic component will be assigned with a particular code. So if any fault in that component, immediately the diagnostic system will intimate to the driver and it will store that code. So why the diagnostic is needed? So in order to identify any defecting of any problem while driving, providing as a backup and maintain the safe driving, subsequent damages. If any small problem is there, that problem should not be able to develop as a bigger problem. Report the problem to the driver, store the fault according to, for example, at a particular driving condition, some problem may come. Not for entire driving condition it will come. So according to the environmental condition, it will store the problem. It will indicate to the driver. All these functions needs to be needed for the presence of diagnostic system. So this is a simple diagnostic system management. Like this is the part of the ECU. Till this line, this will be part of the ECU. That's what we'll call as the onboard diagnostic. So this DSM will be present inside the microcontroller program. Okay, so you don't get confused. This is any other hardware or not. This is a part of the ECU program. So all the sensors, actuators, system level functions, everything will be monitored by this DCM, sorry, DSM, this diagnostic system management. If any fault is there through that onboard, that's what we'll call as OBD, onboard diagnostic, it will immediately indicate in the form of light in the cluster. And it will immediately stores code, the fault code. And you can able to connect the generic scan tool, either laptop or a tester, through the separate port pin in the each and every ECU, and you can able to see the code, and according to the code the service technician can able to change the, or you can he can able to service the fault. Okay, again I'm repeating, if any fault is there, that fault will be displayed to the driver to take the vehicle towards the service station, and the fault will be stored in the memory. And once you can able to connect the diagnostic tester to the ECU, it can able, you can easily able to trace that fault, and that fault can be able to serviced either by the service technician, or it can able to get the help from the plant in the sense company. So what can be done in the diagnostic test? Diagnostic test is an interface between the personal or a laptop computer and the vehicle diagnostic bus. Through that you can able to reprogram the controller if any fault is not rectified. The hardware and software comprises of which will read the most OBD onboard diagnostic data as well as diagnostic trouble codes. So through the scanner or the diagnostic tool, you can able to read the codes. Provides a useful data for monitoring real-time data, troubleshooting and repair purpose. So through that data, trouble code, you can able to troubleshoot it and repair the thing, and you can able to manipulate the calibration data. So this is a typical scanner, handheld scanner, and the scan tool companion in the laptop. So through this you can able to read the fault, and that fault you can directly go and trace that fault. For example, P001 is assigned to crankshaft sensor pin number 1. That is fault means you can directly go to the crankshaft sensor pin number 1 and you can able to check it. And the next important thing is that the operating conditions. The ECU is supposed to operate in with the presence of a lot of corrosive liquids, dust, sand, fuel, contaminants, salt, spray, higher temperature, vibration, extreme electrical interferences. So while manufacturing the ECU, all these parameters has to be taken care, and based on this the proper production has to be happened. Thank you. For any further informations or any doubts, please contact my mail ID.